I do many things, but one thing I'm very much known for is working in schools, particularly around the UK, and a great deal in London, teaching poetry and creative writing. Go to a school and you empower a young person, and then you say, go to the library and find some books, and they come back to you and say, I can't find any books. And then basically what happens, this great spark that you sparked off basically stops. As a kid growing up, I grew up in East Dulwich, Peckham, when it wasn't cool. Now some people live in Peckham, they're like, oh my god, you can live there. Back then, it was a no-go area. In fact, for many of us kids growing up there, we referred to it as a war zone. We didn't even call it Peckham, we called it Vietnam. And there were two schools in my area. There was William Penn, where all of the bad boys went. I really wanted to go there. They were cool kids. They walked as if one of their legs was shorter than the other. They kind of swung their hands a bit like this. And they talked in a language that only their friends could understand. I wanted to go there. My mum, unfortunately for me, is from Ghana in West Africa. This means that education is very important in her life. What this means is she basically said to me, you can't go to William Penn, you're going to go to Allen's. You don't know Allen's, it's kind of a subsidiary of Dulwich College. It's a posh school. I was in the school with Jude Law. He was pretty and all the girls loved him. But one of the things that I found there is because I walked in there very naively thinking that basically, you know, the world was about equals and so on and so forth. And I found it really, really hard. I just found it like a really hard environment to be in. Because in the time I was there of 1,000 kids, there were only 4 black kids in school in the whole time that I was there. So I'm in this place, and I'm really trying to find myself. I'm trying to find my voice, because although I wanted to be one of the bad boys that walked around Peckham High Street, I just couldn't do it. That wasn't me. And I didn't play rugby, so I wasn't really fitting in with those kids either. I was just kind of floundering in the playground, crying. And I had a teacher called Mrs. Shepherd, who I will say saved my life with two things. He said to me one day, I'm going to give you two things that will change your life. I'm going to give you a weapon, and I'm going to give you a best friend. I kind of looked around his body like, where are these people? Where's the weapon? And he gave me a pen. I was like, what am I going to do with that? He said, you're going to write down how you feel in your new best friend, which is the book, which I'm going to give you. And he just imparted me this kind of power of words, because in the book, I could do whatever forms of torture to the people who were bullying me in my school as I could get away with. And he also gave me an amazing book, The Catcher on the Rye, by Jamie Salinger. It just, and just immersed myself in that book just changed my life forever. And it gave me a voice, and I've always said that words and literature have been my kind of access all areas pass. It's allowed me entrance to activities and experiences and to meet people who I'm not supposed to meet, because I'm the black guy from Peckham who's the son of Faustina, who came to England from Ghana in the 50s. I'm one of those kids. So basically for me it's kind of, going to schools and working with young people is really, really important. But one of the things that's really interesting is what happens is you kind of empower people with words, you know, you show them an alternative life, and you know, you try and kind of push them through a literature world which isn't necessarily that welcoming at times. And then you have children, your own children, like your own little yous, and that's when it really strikes home. Because obviously, when they're kids, you're going to read them The Rabbit That Loves Me, you might give them a little bit of Charlotte's Web, and so on and so forth. But at some point, your daughter is going to look at you and say, why aren't I in any of the books? And then your son's going to join in and he's going to say, I love Alex Rider. Alex Rider's really cool. But he doesn't live in South London. And he's never been on a bus. And most importantly, when Alex Rider wakes up in the morning, he doesn't have to put on the mask. And the mask is basically the protective thing that a lot of kids who basically, you know, and we're here talking about, who really need that diversity, have to put on the mask in order to survive the day. But you're 6 years old. And so books become really important because that's the imagination of escape. When I'm immersed myself in a book and I'm surrounding myself in the words and I'm feeling the words in my mouth and I'm tasting the words and I'm spitting the words out and I'm having real fun playing with the words, I'm not in South London anymore. I'm in Narnia without blue boys. So the thing I say to you is basically, like a lot of kids, you know, they're facing a really hard time because it's hard to be a child right now. Because from the moment that you wake up to the moment that you go to sleep, from the moment you wake up to the moment you go to sleep, you're being bombarded by ideas and images of a life that you cannot access. That's one thing. So just imagine this, if basically, when you wake up, you don't see yourself on the TV, you're not on any billboards, when your mum takes you to foils, you're not on the covers, you're not in any posters, and if you're lucky, there's a small little section that's kind of tucked away in the shop for you to go and flip through the same books that are in the small section that are in W.A. Smith's, that are in the small section that are in the boutique bookshop. And basically what I'm saying is, we just need more. One of the things we also need is, we need diverse stories. Because the thing is about a lot of these kids is, if you're growing up on an estate, you don't want to read about your estate. You want to read about other people like yourself who are living a different life. Because we're not all on the estate, and we're not all listening to Stormzy, and basically we're not all wearing tracksuits. But basically, it doesn't matter how many times I go into school and how many kids I've empowered, and I've turned the lives around of many, many kids. And if you've ever worked in schools and basically worked on a poetry project, you know, and then had a really amazing experience with a group of kids and then lost those kids to knife crime or gun crime or whatever, you say to yourself, well, there's only so much I can do. And I spend a large amount of time in rooms like this, but I'm the only one. And basically, what I'm saying to you is, we need your help. We need you to speak to your bosses and say, actually, if we're going to go and take three Harry Potter books, let's not even take a Benjamin Zephaniah book or a George the Poet book. Let's go and find some other stories that exist in these communities. And ultimately, at the end of the day, as a parent, we have cash and we like to spend it. And we will invest in the literature industry if the literature industry invests in us. Yeah. The last thing that I will say to you, Greenaway's worth after me. My pen. Okay, don't be BBC, you need a bit more. Wave your hands around if you want. My pen.
My pen.
Is a weapon, I said.
Is a weapon, I said.
It's the microphone.
It's the microphone.
That allows my tongue to say things I'm too afraid to whisper. It's a submachine gun of truth. It's a bullet shell of ink that spills blue blood on paper. It's the memory of what my teacher said. It's the indelible cousin of pencil lead. It's a silent movie on a snow white paper screen. It's an instrument of opportunity and it allows people to dream. It's a path. It's an exit. And it's a way out. And it's a way for these kids to be heard. Without having to shout. My pen. That's how important words, pens, and literature are to young kids in schools, colleges, universities, estates, PRUs, prisons, young offenders institutes today. And we need your help. My name is Tommy Dark. Thank you.